This is Scott Becker with a chance to visit today with the brilliant lawyer, Andrea Lee Lina. Andrea is a partner at McGuire Woods. She's an expert in the digital health area, digital technology area. She's going to talk about some of the things she's seeing today, both digital issues and healthcare legal issues that apply to those and a lot more. Andrea, take a moment to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about you.
Yeah, thanks, Scott. Well, thanks for having me. I'm a huge fan of you and your podcast, so I'm excited to be a guest. I'm a healthcare attorney partner at McGuire Woods. I'm the co-leader of the Digital Health Innovation and Technology Group, which is a new practice group that we just got off the ground about 2-3 months ago, so we're super excited to bring that to McGuire Woods. And I focus my practice on digital health. I help healthcare companies navigate telehealth, remote patient monitoring, wearables, emerging technologies, HIPAA, healthcare IT, and then I also work with healthcare companies on PE deals and other regulatory compliance matters. I absolutely love working in this space. Digital health is incredibly helpful to me as a busy working professional, but I also see how it can help so many underprivileged communities, working women in pediatrics, elderly, really expanding access across the spectrum. So it's truly a privilege to work in this space.
And fantastic. And you have a magnificent reputation as a thinker, as a lawyer, and leader. Talk to us a little bit about what are some of the digital health issues that you're following, you know, closely?
Yeah, so I am definitely following where is digital health going post-pandemic. I know I'm not alone in this. This is really the question right now in the digital health space. I'm particularly watching Medicare as the biggest payer. What Medicare does, really, the market a lot of times will follow. So prior to the pandemic, Medicare paid for a limited number of telehealth services. So you had to, the beneficiary had to be, for example, in an office or a facility, and also had to be in a certain geographical area, in a rural area. And this was extremely limited because if you were in your home, for example, you couldn't receive telehealth services, and you were in any area that's considered an urban area, you couldn't receive telehealth services and be covered by Medicare. And that's just not major cities, New York City and Chicago. I mean, these really expansive definition of what's an urban area. So it was very limiting, very small percentage of Medicare participants qualified to receive telehealth services. So when the pandemic happened, it was really exciting because all of those limitations were lifted. Suddenly, Medicare beneficiaries could be in their home as well as urban areas. CMS added, I think, 140, 150 new telehealth services that were reimbursable that were never reimbursable before. CMS started paying the same rate for telehealth services, whether in person or over telehealth. So these are wonderful expansions. This huge percentage increase in the number of individuals that have been using telehealth over the pandemic. But now that we're seeing more vaccinations and we're all hoping that we're almost to the end here, there's this ongoing debate about, okay, what of this, how much of this should be permanent? And so that is really where I'm focused in trying to help navigate for clients what that looks like, help investors think about what's going to continue in the future. If you're going to invest in this area and you're going to continue to build these programs, it's absolutely a critical question. So we're seeing more and more information out of Washington providing clues about what potentially will happen, but we still don't have really concrete answers yet. For example, just a couple weeks ago, there was a lot of movement in this area through MedPAC, which stands for the Medicare Payment Advisory Committee. And they basically make policy suggestions to Congress, bipartisan committee, and they issued nonpartisan committee, and they issued a policy option to Congress saying that they should expand Medicare telehealth coverage on a temporary basis, so only for 1 to 2 years after the public health emergency. So what they're proposing isn't really what we all want. We all want Medicare to cover telehealth just like they've been doing in the pandemic, after the pandemic, for, you know, not in a temporary way for only 1 or 2 years. So that was interesting news, and I think not what people were expecting. So we are continuing to watch that and see if that's going to evolve, because there are also bills, for example, Protecting Access to Post-COVID Telehealth Act, where this is saying, you know, we're going to eliminate some of these geographic restrictions. We're going to allow people to have telehealth in their home or an urban area permanently. We're not just going to do it for 1 or 2 years. It's going to be a permanent change. So really trying to watch and forecast what we think is going to happen in that area is just incredibly important to think about, okay, where are we going to be 1 year, 2 years, or 10 years down the line?
When you look at that, the sort of middle ground on telehealth for the long run versus, you know, it seems intuitive to us or obvious to us at first glance that you just continue it because it really gives patients a lot more options. It makes it a lot more efficient. You don't have to drive for the day to make your doctor's appointment. Mm-hmm. For many people, it's hard to get in and out. But what I hear is that the sort of counter to that position is that the perception in this committee or in Congress that there will be added cost to the system, that it won't be substitute for other visits. It will be some addition mm-hmm. to visits. And then the second thing I hear is that the real political opposition comes, strangely enough, from possibly health systems and others that are concerned that if you totally open the door to telehealth, it'll be the Amazons of the world that end up winning in that battle. And thus there's some unexpected built-in opposition from parties that embrace telehealth, want some regulations and controls around it so they don't get, you know, whipsawed by the Amazons of the world and some of the other private equity-funded telehealth companies. And I don't know how much of that is conjecture or that's what drives some of the hesitancy, you know, or if you're hearing anything around those issues.
Yeah, one thing that's interesting as I continue to monitor the bills and the MedPAC report and the like is there's a lot of talk about we just don't have enough information yet to make these changes permanent. So clinical trials, studies, they're all calling for these. We just need more information. We need to have studies about are the services that you receive over telehealth really comparable to what you receive in person. So MedPAC, for example, is saying, well, we're going to expand this for 1 or 2 years because we are giving time for these studies. So, and you're seeing that across the board in so many different bills that have been proposed. So to me, that's another area where I think there's some hesitancy just because obviously it is a big leap to say, you know, we're going to increase the spending is what a lot of people think will happen. Just like you said, it's not going to be a replacement, it's going to be a supplement. So it's going to increase the cost per beneficiary for the Medicare program. So there needs to be some more studies there, some more data. And I think that's another piece that we're going to continue to see a lot of focus on is, you know, how soon can we get that information and can we really act before we have that data?
Fascinating and so interesting. Talk a little bit about, so this is a huge issue, this telehealth issue, virtual care issue, and whether Washington will allow it for the long run or there will be a period of time. Somehow or another, we think it's probably here to stay in some version, but it'll be interesting to see what limits are on it. What about commercial payers? How are commercial payers going to deal with virtual health, telehealth visits, and so forth? What are you hearing there?
Yeah, I'm hearing a very similar, well, during the pandemic, you know, it was very similar in that they really opened things up dramatically and followed what Medicare was doing as far as expanding access, expanding, lowering in the cost of care, allowing more individuals, more clinicians to provide telehealth and have those services covered. So I think it's very similar. And the more, again, as Medicare is making these movements, I think that commercial payers are paying attention to that and seeing what is the expectation in the community and what are our beneficiaries expecting? You know, where is the federal government going? Where are state governments going? And I think state governments are another piece of this that I haven't touched on yet, which is they are also, you know, each state is just rapidly changing in its own way. Some are completely opening the door to telehealth. Others are limiting telehealth in some way. So this, again, it's just kind of watching all these different spectrums about, you know, federal government, commercial payers, state government, what are patients expecting? Is there the same utilization that we're expecting post-pandemic? So it's really just monitoring all of those together and trying to get an idea of where things will be, because again, investors and clinicians and providers that are investing in the space they want to know that this is a good investment and that this makes sense for us going forward.
Fascinating. A different question, Andrea. You've got this great career, great leader, fascinating to visit with always. What advice do you have for people trying to have terrific careers or trying to be great leaders? Two or three pieces of advice you'd give somebody trying to be a great leader.
Yeah, I think never stop improving. I think that is, you hear it all the time, but it's so true. Great leaders, great people are constantly learning and trying to improve themselves, constantly trying to think about how can I provide better services to my clients? How can I be a better leader to my team? How can I build better teams, expand my expertise in healthcare? It's all incredibly important. And that's really what drove me to healthcare in the first place, was this idea of constant change, constant learning. I mean, there is always something new to be on top of or learn about. And that's true, COVID or not COVID. So I absolutely love that about the healthcare space. You just can never be still. You've got to be out there reading and learning and talking to people. So definitely that would be my advice, is truly never stop improving.
No, I think that's wonderful advice, Andrea. I want to thank you for taking a moment today to join the Becker's Healthcare Podcast and shedding some light on this telehealth issue as to whether reimbursement is going to continue for Medicare, how it's going to continue, what it's going to look like, and so forth. I really appreciate you taking the time to join us today. Andrea, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for having me.